Praise God, praise God, praise God. Thank you for joining me this morning for Shalom Morning Prayer. All of those who have joined the prayer personally, and also to all of you who faithfully joined the prayer through our archives. So praise the Lord for you as well. But always remember, there's no distance in the spirit realm. You know, those of you who's in the archives, might not be there physically, but the Holy Spirit, He's there. And He's the one who commune and fellowship with us. Praise the living God. Now, remember, we have Shalom Morning Prayer every Tuesday morning at 8 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. And you can call 720-820-1674. Now, for international callers, if you desire to personally tune in with us and pray, then you visit the webpage at freeconferencecall.com/wall/evangelistking and look for your country dial-in number. Once you find your country dial-in number, then you enter SS code 790943. Now, it may be some countries that's not listed, so you have to call the 720-820-1674 number, okay? So praise the living God. You know, dear Lord, as I was meditating over what the Lord wanted me to focus on our prayer today, you know, I just can't help from thinking about a young lady that I did a deliverance session on yesterday. She's a sweet young lady. And dear Lord, you know, when we look at a person in the natural, they do look like there's a good girl and a good boy. You know, when I say good girl, good boy, because I'm old enough to be this young lady's mother. Because in the eyes of God, when God looks at us, He looks at us, you know, as His dear children. You know, I know some of us have a problem. I'm a woman. I'm a man. That's arrogance. But Lord said, unless we come as a little child, we cannot inherit the kingdom of God. So it shouldn't even bother you when someone call you a little girl, a little boy. You say, thank you. You know, that's a compliment, because we have to keep that childlike attitude in order, you know, to receive the grace of God upon our lives if we want to grow in the Lord. So as I'm thinking about this young lady, you know, when she first friended my page, the Lord spoke to me and said, I sent her for deliverance. Now, when He said that, the Holy Spirit also revealed to me some things. She don't think she needs deliverance, you know, because she considered herself a good girl, knowing good and well that she had not done good things, but she had repented, asked the Lord to forgive her, she repented. So therefore, she still thought she was a good girl, you know, and that she did not need deliverance. So the Lord told me, when you call her, make sure you mention to her that you no longer do private session. All sessions are public, recorded, and shared on all your programs. So I mentioned that to her. I said, now, if you agree to these terms, then I can continue with your session. If not, I cannot. And when I said it, she said, oh, boy. I felt the hesitancy. I felt she just wasn't willing to let everybody know that she wasn't such a good girl after all. And so I explained to her, I said, there's none good but the Father. And so our scripture reference, dear Lord, is coming from Luke, the 18th chapter, verse 18. So I explained to her, I said, we must be willing to give up our reputation. Jesus gave up His reputation for us. We must be willing to give up our reputation. We must realize on this earth there are no good girls, there are no good boys. I said, even Jesus Himself, which is in Luke 18:18, it said that one of the leaders in Christ's day asked Him, and he first looked at Jesus, he said, good rabbi, that means good teacher, what should I do to attain eternal life? Now, we know Jesus had never sinned. So this man called Jesus good. But Jesus didn't do as we would have done. In our heart, we would have received that. You know, we'll say, thank you. But in our heart, we will receive being good. But Jesus did not do that, because Jesus did not want to set an example for us in that we think that we are good or our flesh is good. The scripture said in 19, Jesus said to him, "Why are you calling me good?" Now, Jesus said that, "Why are you calling me good?" Even though Jesus never did any wrong, but Jesus refused to receive in his heart that he was good. Because again, he wanted to set that example that there's no goodness in the flesh. We all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. You know, when people pay us a compliment, we say thank you. But in our heart, dear heart, we know who that compliment belongs to. And that compliment belongs to God through his son, Jesus Christ, by his spirit. Just like Jesus told this leader here, "Why callest me good?" He said, "No one is good but God." So Jesus was telling him, God is good. Because Jesus was setting that example. Again, we knew that Jesus was good. But he set that example because he was in the flesh. Because if he didn't set that example, then that would give you and I a reason to accept being good when people call us good. No, dear heart, all glory belongs to Jesus Christ. You know, the goodness that we do comes from God through Jesus by his spirit. If the Lord would take his spirit away from us, we would see just how good we are. We are not good. So as I shared this with this young lady. Look, you must be willing to give up your reputation. Dear heart, we must realize that our flesh got to stay crucified. You know, flesh love to be spoken nice things to and about. But we know by God's spirit that is only the Holy Spirit in us who is good. As I told the young lady, I said, there are no good girls and there are no good boys. I said, and then the Lord said, remember, there used to be. I said, oh yeah, there used to be before sin. Adam and Eve was a good girl and a good boy. But once they sinned, from that very important moment, everyone was born in sin, shaped in iniquity. Everyone. We all have sinned, come short. So there's no good girls and no good boys. So we must be willing to give up our reputation. It's not about us. It's always about Jesus Christ. Regardless, again, of any goodness that we do for someone, you know, a person is supposed to say thank you. And you say, you're welcome. But deep down in the heart, dear heart, we give that praise and that glory to Jesus Christ. Be careful, because the flesh loves to be pumped up, puffed up. You know, when people call us good, it makes the flesh happy. And anytime the flesh get happy, that's the indication that the flesh is not crucified. Your flesh is not crucified. Praise the living God. And then after Jesus told the ruler, the young ruler, that no one good but the Father, and Lord said, well, you know the law. You know what it said. Don't commit adultery. Don't murder. Don't steal. Don't give false testimony. Honor your father and mother. And then the young man said, I kept all this since I was a boy. See, he felt like he was a good boy. I did all of that when I was a boy. Then Jesus, in verse 22, he said, on hearing this, Jesus said to him, there's one thing you still lack. Dear heart, let's always remember that. There will always be one thing that we lack. You know, regardless how good we think we are, Jesus said there is one thing that we still lack. It's like this young man who said he had done all of that, and he actually felt that he was a good boy. But the Lord said, no, still there's one thing you lack. And the Lord touch his lackness. And only the Lord can touch our lackness. And that's the reason why we must stay low and humble. Again, you know, we are supposed to honor and exalt one another. But when that happens, dear heart, again, in our heart, we redirecting that praise, we redirecting that glory and honor to Jesus Christ in our heart. We redirect and we smile at the person and say, thank you. And then, dear heart, that's an opportunity for us to testify of the goodness of God, to let that person know that it is not I who is good, it is only God through his son Jesus by his spirit. Without him, there's no way I could be good. It's only through him. See, God gives us opportunities to testify of him. So every time someone say that we are good, we are a good person, that's an opportunity to testify to that person about Jesus Christ. Because that's all the Holy Spirit does. When the Holy Spirit who's in us, he only glorifies and testifies of Jesus. He don't glorify and testify about us. He only glorifies and testifies about Jesus. So in the good works of goodness that we do, and the people recognize it, and they start exalting us, we say thank you. But then again, we redirect that praise and glory to the Father. Then we open up our mouth and we let people know that this goodness that you see coming through me is not me, but it's God. God, through his son Jesus, by his Holy Spirit. Because it's only God who is good. Praise the living God. So again, the Lord told this young ruler, if this is one thing you still lack. Because God looks at the heart. See, people cannot see our heart, dear heart. But Jesus knows our heart. So he told the young man, go and sell what you have and distribute the proceeds to the poor. And you will have riches in heaven. And then come and follow me. And then the scripture said, but the young man, when he heard this, he became sorrow in heart. He became sad because he was very rich. You see, he loved his riches. Because he actually thought because he was prosperous in his finances, he had a nice home, nice car, he had a nice wife, and children were nice, and people treated him nice, and he just had it all. He looked at that as his evidence of pleasing God. And that's why he actually thought he was good. But Jesus, no, you still lack one thing. His wealth. He trusts in his wealth. He was not trusting in God. According to God's riches in glory, he was trusting in his riches that he attained on this earth. So again, dear heart, you know, as I think about this young lady and praise God, you know, I conversed with her for 3 hours. You know, and I usually don't do that, but she was different. You know, she just coming into the knowledge of the things of God. So the Holy Spirit had to take his time with her and show her that she had to be willing to give up her self ambitions, to give up her self desire, to crucify her flesh. She must even give up herself, even though she has given up other things. You know, she once lived with a man and she gave that up because she wanted to please God, but she hadn't given up herself. Sometimes, dear heart, we're holding ourselves as a God. We're holding ourselves. Why? Because we are ashamed. We are ashamed of certain things in our life that we knew that is not well-pleasing in the eyes or ears of other people. So we want to keep that hidden. We want to keep that hidden. I'm not going to expose that to no one. And as I was sharing with this young lady, I said, I was the same way. I said, I did some things in my life that, and once I came to Jesus, I had made up in my heart and mind that nobody would ever know, especially my children. This particular thing I did not want my children to know about. And I said, I'm going to keep it a secret. Only people are going to know is me, God, and the devil, because the devil was right there too. But praise the living God. And I told her when the time came, and when I was ministering to someone, the Lord said, Terry, tell your testimony. And I knew exactly what God was talking about. He was talking about that thing that I had said within myself I would never expose. And so I love the Lord. And when the Lord tell you to do something, you must obey. We choose. Am I going to glorify God? So dear heart, again, God want us to glorify him. You know, stop looking at ourselves as good. but look at ourselves only as good through Christ Jesus. And when we look at ourselves only as good through Christ Jesus, then when people call us good, then we can say, thank you, Father, for giving me this opportunity to share you with my sister, share you with my brother. And that is when we redirect them to Jesus Christ and letting them know there's only one person who's good, and that is God. Because why? Jesus set that example for us in Luke 18, verses 21. No, let me see. But anyway, starting at verse 18, yeah, verse 19. So Saint Luke 18, verse 19, Jesus set us an example what to say to people when they call us good. Again, we say thank you, but at the same time in our heart, we say thank you, Heavenly Father, for opening up this opportunity so I can share that your goodness with my sister and brother who is thinking that I am good. And that is when we redirect that goodness to God and telling them there's none good but God. Because that's what Jesus did. When that young ruler called him good, he said, why are you calling me good? No one good but the Father. Now, I have a lot of people saying I'm good all the time. I say thank you. But I redirect them to Jesus Christ and letting them know Advantage King ain't good. It's only God through Advantage King. Because all it takes is God is to take his spirit away, and you will see just how good Mrs. Terry B. King is. I am not good. Only the Father. And I thank him. You know, he gives me opportunity to share him with others, because again, dear, that's what the Holy Spirit does. So our prayer is that, dear heart, let's pray one for another in the heart, from the heart. Now, a lot of times when we pray, we will pray for people from our mouth, but it's not coming from the heart. And I thank God that since we've had this prayer line and things that we pray, I have seen God bring those things to pass. God had let me see him bring those things to pass. So don't think that God is not hearing us and he's not bringing those things to pass, because he is. And I praise him, I thank him. So my heart is going out for my brother and my sister who Satan have got blind. He got blinders on them. They're not giving that glory from the heart to Jesus Christ whenever someone called them good. Again, you know, we can easily make it sound like we are, but God looks in the heart and he sees in the heart. And in the heart, we're not redirecting that praise and that glory to God. Because if we really was redirecting that praise and glory to God, then we will open our mouth and tell the person, thank you, but dear heart, none good but God. To God be the glory. God is so good. And the same God who works in me to show forth his goodness, he desires to work in you to show forth his goodness. That's an opportunity where we can glorify him, because it's always and always will be about him. As I was telling that young lady, there's only one person who thinks they are good, and that is Satan, who used to be Lucifer. He thinks he's a good boy. He thinks he's good. He thinks he's good. He don't need God, because he actually thinks he's good. And he don't do good things, but he thinks he's good. He's deceived. Satan is, that's why he's a deceiver, because he's deceived. He's deceived. He's twisted. His mind is twisted, dear heart. So let's imitate Christ Jesus. He is our example. That when someone calls us good, Christ, now you say thank him, because we are supposed to praise and exalt one another. But the receiver, we know in our heart that goodness belongs to God, and only him who is good. So again, let's pray for our brothers and sisters, pray for one another, that God will take the blindness off. And that one thing that we still lack, that the Lord says, that as he did this young ruler, that he will reveal it to us. Because there is one thing that we lack. Regardless of the goodness that I do, There's always that one thing that I lack. And I must trust the Lord that the Lord will show me what that lackness is. And I must ask him to help me to accept the way that he corrects me, the way that he chastised me, so that Jesus can continue to show forth his good works through me and help me to always to be as that child, that humble child, that child who always willing to receive instruction, that child who always willing to learn. You know, if you really look at a little child, they're eager to learn new things, you know, and that's why they're very humble and submissive, a child. And that's what we have to continue to be like according to the word of God so we can inherit eternal life. So let's just pray for one another and pray, just pray for our brothers and sisters in that, again, God do his word to take the blinders on there. It's like in the spirit realm, Satan has some glasses, eyeglasses in the spirit realm. They're dark, and he puts them on a person's eyes where they cannot see light. They cannot see truth. All they see is a dim light, and any light that is dim is considered to be darkness. A dim light, dear heart, is darkness. A dim light is not light. That is darkness. And when it comes down to the children of God, they got some of them got those blinders on, and they only can in the spirit realm now. That's why in the natural realm you're seeing a lot of people wearing shades 24/7. You know, they don't just wear shades when they're driving their car and the sun is beaming against the windshield and blinding them, and it protects their eye. No, they wear shades all the time. There's a spiritual meaning to that. There's a spiritual meaning to that. A person wearing shades all the time. Because wearing shade all the time, you're not seeing light. It's dark that represents darkness. So, dear heart, be careful. If you're the one who wears shades all the time, you need to ask the Holy Spirit, why are you wearing shades all the time? Ask the Holy Spirit. Remember, the Lord said, still, there is one thing you lack that could be the thing that you lack. That's the evidence, an outward side of an evidence that something is wrong in the spirit realm if you wear shades all the time. That's not the purpose of wearing shades. You wear shades all the time, dear heart. You're looking through eyes of darkness there. And again, a dim light is still considered to be darkness. So if you're wearing shades all the time, Lord saying, you take them shades off. Take them off. You only use them when maybe you are in direct contact in the sun and you have to put them on to protect your eyes. That's the purpose of shade. But if that's not the reason why you're wearing them, Lord, so you take them off because there's a significant meaning to it in the spirit realm. See, do what? We don't know what we think we know. You know, Holy Spirit is the one who revealed to us things. That's why we have to stay low and humble as a child here. You know, so we pray again for one another because, again, you know, God's children are lack in understanding of his word. But the first thing is first, we must die to self. It's no more I, but it's Christ who lives in me. So let's pray in Jesus' mighty name. So, Father, once again, I thank you for this amazing Father, opportunity to be with thank your children. You I thank you, Father, for your mercy for your and grace. I thank you for your love presence, and your right compassion now. That you have for
thank
us,
you for your grace
but
and
Father.
Your mercy,
you
Father,
refuse to share
day,
us with the
every
enemy.
Day forward,
Father, only you
thank
can
you,
look
Father,
deep down in us and see
morning,
that one
Father,
thing
God,
that we still lack, and we ask you, Father, to expose that lackness,
Father.
And help us to be willing to accept
us,
your
Father.
Correction.
Take
your
back the layers,
truth, Father,
God. Take
truth
back the layers,
us.
Lord Jesus.
Father, ask
like
you, Father,
anything
to help
that is in
our
us, Father. In any of the areas,
spirit,
Father, that you may reign in from the top of,
you,
the crown of our head to the toes of our feet, Father. We ask you
to
expose it in your firepower of the Holy Spirit in Jesus' mighty name. We thank you, Lord. We thank you because you said, Father, in your word that whatever we ask, in Jesus' name, the Son, your Son, Father, that it shall be done.
We love
in Jesus' mighty name, we thank you. We thank you right now, Father, for all the people that's out there, our friends and our family, Father, that you are drawing near to you, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Father. We ask you to keep opening our mind, Father. Give them a heart to desire the things of God, Father. Give them the strength to keep pushing on, Father. Give them the desire to go into your word and find your wisdom, Father God. In Jesus' mighty name, and for the ones who have already been baptized and have the Holy Spirit, Father, awaken them. Give them a fresh cleansing, of the Holy Spirit once again, Father God. Awaken something in them, Father. You are the one who draws your children near to you, Father. We just ask you to activate it right now, Jesus. Take off the shades, Father, in everyone's life. From here to everyone that we touch today, Father, to all the friends and the family that we have, Father, take the shades off. Reveal to each one of us and each one of our family, each one of our friends, Father. Go to the workplace, Father, and touch the minds and the wills of all the souls that we touch, Father. All the souls that call on your Son's name. In Jesus' name, we ask you to reveal the truth to them, Father God, because you are the one who draws them near to you, Lord. Draw them near to you, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name, use us, Father, as vessels of light, Father, like a lighthouse, like a boat that's lost in the sea, that's looking for you, that's looking for the refuge, that's looking for salvation, Father. Use us, Father, as light, and give us wisdom and revelation that will help your children, Father God. In Jesus' mighty name, we ask you to keep teaching us, Father. Keep comforting us with your Holy Spirit. Keep us, Lord. Keep us in your word. Bring it back to us in those times of need, Father God. Keep us humble so that we may hear your voice and know your calling and know when you are pulling us, Father God. Keep us humble. Keep us in your faith, Father God. We thank you. We thank you and we thank you and we thank you because we can't thank you enough, Lord Jesus, because you are so worthy, and you are so worthy, Father, of the praise and the honor, God, and the mercy, Father, that you give us, Father, that we don't even deserve. In Jesus' mighty name, we thank you, Lord, because we can't thank you enough. We thank you, Lord, because we can't thank you enough. In Jesus' mighty name, so we give you the highest praise, Father. We give you the highest praise and the highest glory, because your throne is in the heavens, and your kingdom rules over all. In Jesus' mighty name, Father, touch my children, Lord Jesus. Surround them by your angels, Father God. Protect them. Draw walls around them, Father God, like you did Job, Father God. And cover those walls with the blood of the Lamb, Father, that protects them from all the fiery darts, Lord Jesus. Give them strength, Father God. Put the shield of righteousness and a helmet of salvation with them, Father God. In Jesus' mighty name, just keep giving us strength, Father God, to keep going, Father, when it doesn't feel like it, when the world has turned around on all of us, Father, when it's not cool to be a Christian, Father God, when it's not cool to be a follower of you, Father God. Keep discipling us, Father. Keep showing up in our lives, Father. Keep proving yourself and keep glorifying yourself in us, Father, so that the world may know your name, so that the world may see you and you us in unity, Father, and we may rise, Father, and you may rise in us because we glorify you, Father, in all of our works and all of our actions, Father God. We glorify you, Father God, so let us sanctify ourselves. Keep us in sanctity of you, Father God. Keep us in your will, Father God. Keep us in your will, Father God. Give us the strength to stay in your will. Help us to endure each day, each moment, Father God, as we go forth, Father. Help us to remind us, Father, that it is only through you, Father. It is only through you that we get through this day and the pain, Father God. It is only through you, Lord. It is only all the goodness that we have, Father. It is only through you. Help us to die every day, every moment to ourselves so that you may be glorified once again in us. So the less of us and more of you, Lord.
you protect
less of us and more of you, Lord, in Jesus' mighty name. Less of us and more of you, Lord. Less of us and more of you, Lord. We bless your holy name, and we just thank you, and we lift your name up, Father God, in the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus, we just thank you, Lord. We thank you, Father God. We sing hallelujah to you. We sing hallelujah to your name, Father. We sing hallelujah to your name, Father. And we thank you for your mercy on this day, Father. We thank you for your mercies every day, Lord.
And I ask you,
thank you for your
mercies. To let
we thank you for your grace, Lord. We thank you for forgiving us and help us to forgive those who have gone against us, Father God.
Thank
help
you,
us
Father,
to have faith in you. Help us to have faith in you
Jesus
that you will heal us. You will deliver us from all things, Father. For everything, all our challenges, Lord Jesus, that we have received today. Help us to know, Lord, that you are with us. That you will never forsake us. That you hold us in your right hand, Father God. And that your Son is in heaven sitting beside you, interceding for us right now in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Praise
thank you, Lord.
Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for interceding for
thank
us, Lord.
Glory, glory. You
thank
know, God,
you,
God is really good,
thank
dear Lord. As I was praying, you know, God protects our children, and we don't even think they're in danger. You know, parents, just because your children is there right there in the home with you, and according to your knowledge, they in safety. Physically, they are. But your children was not spiritually. Even though in the physical realm, it appears that your child was safe, but Lord said no, spiritually, demons were attacking your children. Demons were attacking your children. So he had me to pray for your children, because demons were attacking them. Again, you know, we as parents, we know we do what we can to protect our children, but we can only go so far. And we have it because they are with us, and we say they're protected. Lord said they was not protected in the spiritual realm. Demons were attacking your children. So I asked the Lord to send this giant angel with a flaming, fiery sword. And what this angel did, it held out its sword, and it's nothing but a flame of fire. And it was cutting through darkness right there in your children's room, right there in the house where you felt that they were safe, right there in the house. And it cut back that darkness and drove darkness away. So, dear heart, now, in order to keep this safety, you got to monitor your children, even when they're at home and they are with you. You must monitor them. Now, is anybody hearing me?
Yes.
Okay.
I hear you.
I make sure that I was not disconnected.
Hello.
So what you have to do is you have to monitor what they are seeing. The Lord said some of you need to monitor the devices that you give them, because these games and programs that they send on the devices is taking their minds away from him, and demons, they are sneaky. They are entering your children's mind through those programs. All because you want to keep them occupied so you can do whatever you need to do. And you don't realize that you have put your child in danger because your children are opening up their mind to these demons that through those programs. Demons just swooping right into their mind. And that's the reason why they seem to be a little mental or seem to be off. And sometimes they'll scream and they'll holler. And you tell them to hush up, and they won't. And then sometimes they will. You need to think about when your child scream and holler like that. Think about it. That's a demon spirit. That is not that child. The Lord said you got to monitor. You have to monitor the programs on those devices. Just don't. You never just give your child a device to keep them occupied so you can do whatsoever. That's dangerous. Nowadays, because of the technology and knowledge of the world, and that's how a lot of kids are becoming demonized. Okay, so praise his holy name. So those of you again, you need to go back and hear the first portion of of this prayer. I probably, because I have to go in and edit it now since I've been disconnected, and I probably have it up within an hour to post it. So now, as I was ministering, as I was praying, what have the Holy Spirit spoken to you? Only what the Holy Spirit has spoken to you. What have you heard the Holy Spirit say to you? Because one thing I know about the Holy Spirit, He sure will talk to us. You know, I did a message on Monday, and as I was doing that message, all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit rose up in me, and he was talking to somebody, and I felt that He was talking to someone. He said, you asked me to use you. How can I use you when on your job you're stealing time from your employer? Because you are on Facebook all the time. You're on social media all the time. On the employer time. He said, the employer did not hire you to be on social media. He did not hire you to be on Facebook. And you are stealing time. So shut down that Facebook. Shut down that first Facebook and be in obedience to what you was hired to do. Now, again, I felt the Holy Spirit spoke to somebody. So the young lady who notified me on yesterday, who I had a session with, I know I had gotten a comment on it where a young woman said, this thing sure had touched me. They pay no attention to it. So again, you know, as I mentioned her, she the one brought up that she said, you know what? That message show ministered to me. She said, there was no need for me to get angry because it was a truth. She said, I heard God just as good. You said, come off that Facebook. You are still in time from God. And you have the destiny to ask me to use me. She said, I screamed because that's exactly what I kept asking the Lord. Use me, use me. And I heard it, and I'm on Facebook, social media all the time on work. She said, every time I go to work and I take my phone and I just about go to Facebook or social media, I heard you. Get off that Facebook. She said, I heard your voice. Get off that Facebook. You are stealing time from your employer. She said, I got to the point I just leave my phone at home. I don't even take my phone to work anymore. And I told her, I said, as that came out, it was the Holy Spirit through me. I could tell just a good when He comes out through me. And He's talking to specifically to someone. And she said, well, He was talking to me. And I said, not only you, He was talking to many, many more. You just one of those who just told me. But praise the Lord, you know, God dealt with that one thing that she still lacked. You know, she was still in time from her employer by being on Facebook. Your employer did not hire you to be on Facebook or social media. I said, do it on your lunch hour. And I heard it, like when I mentioned do it on your lunch hour, like I heard someone say, oh no, I can't do that. That's my time. And then I said, well, you see, that shows you know what you're doing, because you don't want to do it on your lunch hour because that's your time, but you want to do it on your employer time. Right there, that's wrong. But God got a lot of children who are stealing from their employer. They are stealing time. And how they're doing that is that they are on social media during their work hours when they're not supposed to be. So that's one of the things that some people still lack. And the Holy Spirit, see, the Holy Spirit just don't want anything to come between us and God. He loves us because God is ready to use us, dear Lord. The harvest is great and the laborers are few, and He wants us to be count amongst the laborers. But if we ourselves is not committed wholeheartedly to Him, then how can the Holy Spirit use us to help someone else? So only if you heard the Lord speak to you, those who are on this line, because that when I post this on the archive, the Holy Spirit is going to draw many to listen, and He's going to speak directly to them. But I'm just talking to you all who are on this line. Have the Holy Spirit spoke to you as I minister the word in prayer? If so, speak now, or forever hold your peace, as they say. Okay. Mm-hmm. All right, then, no one coming forth. So anyway, so we praise the Lord.
Oh, wait. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Oh, sorry. You remember
okay,
that?
Okay, this is Liliana. Yes.
I'm not. I'm moving up. You know, Jesus does that. Jesus don't wait on us.
Oh my gosh.
You know, in the scripture he said that if his disciple hadn't yelled out to him to help him, he would have passed them by. He would have passed them by. So go ahead, Liliana. Oh, she got disconnected, and we're gonna hold on for her to call back, y'all. Okay, you on again?
Okay, I'm back.
Okay, all right, you can go ahead.
I just want to say that I felt the Holy Spirit tell me that I need to redeem my time for Him,
mm-hmm.
with Him, to spend time with Him.
Amen.
Reading the word, just like you were saying, getting off from Facebook, just stop browsing the internet and just close my computer and just sit with him and just.
Oh, Lily Allen, if you would do that, girl, I'm telling you, if you would do that, you're talking about an awesome and powerful woman of God. You know, if you would do that, you would actually just as clearly hear Jesus speaking to you. Now, he always speaks to you, but you can't hear him because you're busy doing other things. Jesus never stopped talking to us. It's just that we're not fully, you know, being submitted to him and giving him our undivided attention, we cannot hear him. It's like there's a clog in the drainage. There's a blockage that is preventing us from hearing him.
Yep.
But if you would set time to fellowship with him through his word, they are Facebook, stop writing that internet. And it's not impossible because you got children. I had children. Yeah. And I still fellowship with him. The Holy Spirit will teach you. Matter of fact, the Holy Spirit will work in your children. All of a sudden they get quiet and like they occupied and at peace and they'll go fall asleep. And then that's free time for you to go ahead and fellowship with him. The Holy Spirit will teach you and show you. And when you do that, Leanna, because that's what I did, I'm telling you, you'll be able to hear Jesus clearly. You will be in awe. You'll be like, wow, Jesus, I can hear you. And Jesus would say, Liliana, I've been talking to you all the while, but you just could not hear me.
Yeah.
Because
I've been praying. I want to hear your voice. I want to hear what you say. And he just told me, well, get off the computer.
I often think, I said, Lord, I thank you that when I first came to you that, you know, we didn't know nothing about no computer, you know, the internet. Internet had just come out and it really wasn't popular. And you know, we didn't have no computer, internet or nothing. And I can just see myself now. I would just go and spend that time with him and fellowship with him. And I heard him clearly. I heard him speaking to me. And when I heard him speaking to me, that's when he revealed the things in me that I lacked. And that's when he showed me, and then he led me to my helper. I got delivered, and it was just awesome. So, Liliana, it was awesome. And again, if when you do that, I kid you not, when you do that, Liliana, you would even see or feel demons when they try to attack your children. Because that's how he did. Okay. That's how he did me one time. I was up there fellowshipping with him, and my kids were downstairs. You know, because my parents were living downstairs, and they were downstairs. And I was fellowship with him. Then all of a sudden, he opened up my spirit ears, and I heard a demon giggling and laughing. And Lord said, get up and walk softly downstairs. So I got up, and I walked softly downstairs. As I began to walk softly downstairs, the demons that were giggling, they suddenly stopped. And I said, well, they stopped. Who was down there? And so when I got all the way downstairs, it was two of my two oldest children. They were 8 and 10. And they looked up at me, and Laura said, they're hiding something behind their back. I said, what is that you hiding? Hand it here. And they gave it to me. And it was a toy that we had bought them from McDonald's, you know, where you can get a kid's meal, and they always had a toy. And at that time, we weren't paying special attention to demons in the toy box. That's what you call them, demons in the toy box. And the Lord, because of that incident, the Lord exposed that understanding to us. So I said, honey, here. And the Lord said, look at that poor Terry. So I turned around and looked, and I didn't really see nothing wrong with it. I did, my eyes didn't. Lord said, keep looking. I kept looking. Lord said, Terry, what do that toy symbolize? And I was looking, and then all of a sudden, like the Holy Spirit opened up my eyes. And I said, Lord, they are so sneaky. I said, this thing symbolized a Ouija board. Even though it was not the shape of a Ouija board, it was round, yeah. But the way that it was created and made, it was just like a Ouija board. You had to turn the knob to a letter to spell out a word. And the Lord said, Terry, that's those demons that attached to this toy that had your two girls to turn the knob. And that's who you heard laughing. And I said, give me this thing. And I threw that thing out of my house. And another incident, Lydiana, when I was meditating upon the Lord, thinking of him, just out of blue, I heard him say, Terry, Helen, my oldest, our oldest daughter, she was around 10. He said, just like I'm talking, you hear him say, Terry, Helen is stealing money out of the children's mic bottle. I said, what? So she was at school. And so when she came home to school, I said, come here, Helen. And I put my arms around her and I love her. I said, Helen, baby, are you taking money out of the children's mic bottle? She dropped her head and started crying. I didn't scorn her. I said, Helen, you don't do that, baby. That's stealing. Plus, you're stealing from God. Okay? Don't do that no more. Yes, ma'am. See, at that moment, she became Dolly Sarah. Now, the reason I'm bringing this up, because if I had not spent time with the Lord and fellowship with him and hear his voice, I would never have known these things. Now, on the other end, many, many years later, when I gave in to discouragement and gave up and just focused on working, you know, that's all I focus on, working. Mm-hmm. I was not fellowship with the Lord. I couldn't hear his voice. I actually was in a spiritual coma for 10 years. So I couldn't hear his voice. Well, the enemy entered into my house, even though my girls were home and they appeared to be good girls, but the enemy had them bound. The enemy had them bound. These things happened in my home that would not have happened if I could continue in that fellowship with the Lord. Instead, I gave up and said, I'm just going to be a mother to my children and help Roger take care of the family by working. I just gave up that relationship with the Lord. And that was the biggest mistake I could ever do, because now when I look back, I could see how Satan for 10 years, even though in the natural, they still we still seem to be a good Christian family, but spiritually speaking, we were not in the spirit. We were not. And I could see how Satan had entered into my family and tricked us and called us to sin against God. And it was just a myth. In the spirit realm, it was just a myth. I mean, demons were even in my house. In my house, and demons, when demons in your house, dear heart, they ain't satisfied just being in the house, your house. They want to be in you and your children, especially your children. Mm-hmm. And that spirit was in the house. It was just terrible. But in 2008, it's like the Lord said, okay, Terry, it's your time. And I just woke up out of just sleep. I literally felt like I was asleep when I woke up. And I said, Lord, I was asleep for 10 years. You awoke me. It was his grace and mercy that woke me up. And that was 2008. And I said, okay, devil, I am awake and you are in trouble now in Jesus' name. So God is telling you this, Leah, so you wouldn't go through what I went through, that 10 years being in a spiritual coma. Because that's what happened whenever we refuse to fellowship with the Lord. When we refuse to keep our heart and mind stayed on him, especially when you're a mother at home with your children, Satan gets you say, well, just pay attention to your children. Just raise your children. No, you more than just a housewife or house mom. It's more to you than that. No, No, you don't give up that relationship with Jesus Christ, because only through Jesus Christ who can help you to be a house mom and a mother. Because he's going to open your eyes spiritually. I mean, your husband can be at work and you fellowship with the Lord, and the enemy is working right on his job through spirit of lust through this woman. Your husband might not even be thinking about the woman, but the woman is thinking about your husband, because the devil wants to lure him and draw him into sin. And the Holy Spirit say, Liliana, rebuke that spirit of lust that's in a co-worker on your husband's job. And you can stand right where you are, and you can rebuke that spirit. But if you don't have that fellowship with the Lord, then you don't know these things. And next thing you know, your family is dissolved because your husband would leave you. And see, that's what happened to a lot of housewives. They forget about their relationship in Christ Jesus. Praise his holy name. So thank you, Liliana, for sharing.
Thank you.
And you continue to be an obedient to God, because you truly, truly need to, because your children are so small. Especially that beautiful little girl. You know, I remember you sent me that email regarding your little girl. Now, you saw how the enemy had his eyes on your little girl.
Uh-huh.
The only way you can protect her, spiritually protect her, is that you must keep that communion with God through his spirit. Mm-hmm. Where you can rebuke that spirit. Because just from that look, that spirit is right there looking and waiting for an opening. And since you are your child's covering, and you continue to reject God and keeping that fellowship with him, that would be an open the door for that spirit of lust. It's a spirit now in the spirit realm, spirit of lust that you can't see with your eye. Even though you protect her from the human being, you don't know where the human being is, but that spirit is still there, the Lord say. So as long as you stay submitted to him and commune and fellowship with him, that demon looking for a hole, an opening to enter, it cannot enter. But if you continue to not fellowship with the Lord, then that's an open door. And that spirit of lust, and the first person that spirit of lust gonna go into is your little girl. So that's how you keep that door closed spiritually. You know, you kept it closed physically, but the door got to be closed spiritually. Okay, so obey the Lord. Amen.
Yeah.
So I want to thank everybody for tuning in today. For those of you who listen on the archives, again, we have Shalom Morning Prayer every Tuesday morning at 8 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. You can call 720-820-1674. International, go to our webpage, freeconferencecall.com/wow/evangelistking, to find your country dial-in number and enter SS code 790-943. So, dear heart, stay blessed. In Jesus' mighty name. Shalom, everybody.